So today we're learning about metrics, and to educate us is Pranesh Amir. He currently works at Five, and I'm sure he has a lot of information for us. So let's welcome Pranesh Amir.
Thank you. So yes, I'm Pranesh Amir. I come from Five, and my plan is today to talk about analytics, and this is basically something about me. Just to give you some background, so you know, 8 years ago I graduated on FAIR and I started working as a developer, and after like 4.5 years as a developer I switched to product management. I worked 2.5 years in Estonia for Skype, and during that period as well, at some period of time I was leading a team of data scientists and machine learning experts at Skype. So, you know, at that point I kind of got even more familiar with analytics and metrics. So, yeah, that's something about me. And I'm working at Five, 1.5. So, what is this talk about? I was thinking about, like, when someone asked me, like, and still, like, can you talk about analytics? I was thinking, like, what can I offer, and actually what can I talk about? And I didn't want to talk about technical things about, you know, which events should we report, which analytics tool should you use. I was more like trying to educate about some tips and tricks, maybe best practices, give you some examples, and, you know, examples of where I or my teams failed, or where we kind of use analytics in a good way. And I want to offer some kind of silver bullet solution which will say, okay, if you use this analytic, your product will be awesome. It's more of kind of giving some tips, and as you will see, the presentation won't have some nice animations and illustrations. It's pretty plain because I'm not a designer, so that's my excuse. So I mean, this is kind of generic question of, you know, why use analytics. Most of you know that you should use analytics, that they are good, that you should put some events, that you should kind of instrument like what screens are being you know, used in the most. But it's basically about, you know, understanding your product, understanding like how your users are using the product. If you're a product or project manager, basically to make better decisions, which are data informed, which are not assumptions. I think so, you know, this feature is probably used the most, but actually you have hard data that you cannot, you know, basically, that's it. Like, you have it in data, and that's probably the fact. Also, it helps you monitor how your product performs, as well as identify some potential issues. And, you know, having said all of that, basically, despite all of the, you know, benefits that analytics have, there are, from my experience, a lot of products, a lot of clients, like, that use analytics really, really sparingly, and it's like the bottom of the backlog, and when they need to sacrifice something, it's always analytics. But then, in the end, they're kind of asking themselves, like, and wondering, like, what actually is happening with the product. So the second thing is also, like, even when the products are collecting data properly, they're not analyzed either at all, or are analyzed in the wrong way. So basically, something about analytics in general, and another pattern that I see is that a lot of the projects and products, from the project's perspective, like, people focus on, okay, we need to ship, this is our launch date, and like 95% of the whole focus is on the launch date. And after that, it's like, okay, we've done it, let's focus on new features and the next version. Similar things happen with products, where people are focused on feature, and then once they ship the feature, it's like, okay, we're done, let's focus on the next feature. And a lot of products fail in the step where they actually go back and see how that feature performed, how that product performed. So basically, this whole iterative process of kind of you basically, after you launch something, first step is kind of analyze to see what's happening, how users are using your product. Can you do better? Iterate, try to improve, test it, of course, and then again launch. And it's kind of a never-ending process. Especially if you're working on some product, it's in agile product development. You basically want to always iterate. And what's best that you can see is from the analytics, where are the biggest opportunities for improvements. My take on this is that real fun starts after you launch. So basically, launch is just the beginning. It's an MVP, and then you start. Another thing that I often see, like even a couple of clients that I ask, like, okay, we start working with them on a project. They grant us access to their analytics. And then we ask them, okay, guys, what are your top KPIs? What do you want to focus on? And then after a few weeks of thinking, they send us a document which outlines like 20 metrics. And I mean, it's good to monitor 20 metrics, but these are not your key and product. These are not like your KPIs. You kind of have 20 top KPIs. You need to focus on what's the most important thing. Is it engagement? Is like revenue, is it retention, like what are you actually focused on? And pick these few ones. Don't focus on some proxy metric. That's just a way for you to kind of increase your top metric. Like, so in this graph, basically I outlined one example where actually product is mostly, if it's a paid product, they're concerned and worried about revenue. And that is their kind of top KPI. And there are a couple of supporting KPIs that are also equally important, but they map to the revenue. What I've seen, clients would focus on, let's say, sign-up conversion, and blindly focus on that metric. And they would say, oh, we increased this metric, and it's overall good. But actually, there's no impact on that higher level metric. So basically, it's almost as you didn't do much to increase it, right? So I'm strongly suggest focus on your top KPIs and start from the top, and then see what in which ways you can increase that top KPI. Another thing that happens in product teams, in companies and clients, is that there's no alignment on the KPIs. So basically, if you're working in a product team and one side wants to kind of focus on stability, another side wants to focus on app ratings or revenue or engagement, sometimes they're in conflict, and basically they should all strive towards the same goal. But sometimes the best example is, for example, revenue and engagement. You can put a lot of kind of call to actions buy now, buy, just spam the user, buy now, buy, and you might increase initially your kind of revenue, but users will get irritated with this spamming, and you will just slightly see a drop in engagement, and therefore drop in revenue. So I mean, that's a classical example, but that often happens where marketing team wants to put as many marketing campaigns, and the product team wants to increase engagement, and they are sometimes in conflict, and they need to be actually in balance. Another thing that I see that product team especially says, we want to ship this feature, this would be cool to implement, this would be cool to implement, and actually they don't think about what's the end result you want to move, what's the metric you want to move, how much you think you can move that metric. And maybe better approach is what's your actual metric that you want to move, and then start from that and make an impact map. Let's say in this example you want to increase sign-up conversion. You can just say, we want to do social sign-up. Sure, it will increase probably your sign-up conversion, but there are other ways that you can address that same metric and increase that metric. So think about whether this is at this point, the best solution to increase that metric. And often what happens, even if you ask clients or we as a product team, we're so focused on some new feature, but when we think about which metric do we actually want to move and for how much we think we can move it. And then we come to a point like, it's hard for us to distinguish like, you know, is it 5% that we will increase engagement, is it 10%? What will be our measure of success? Like, if we just say increase engagement, and then after 1 month of development, we see that the engagement increased 1%, would we say that it was a success, right? So, you know, before you even start implementing something, like think about like what impact you expect. Like, and in a lot of the products, both on web and mobile apps, there are a lot of case studies. So, for example, there are case studies of folks who implement the social sign-up, and you can see like what improvement you can actually expect. You can do the math and see like what will be your return of investment. So, advice here is just, you know, focus on the end result, not just like a feature set. You know, see what you wanna achieve. Then classical, you know, chicken and egg or causation versus a correlation problem is it's tricky. Sometimes it's tricky to understand like whether it's a causation or correlation. I gave here kind of two examples where it happens. You analyze statistics and you realize that, you know, users who are really engaged in the first week, they have a high tendency to purchase the product after that first week. And you say, awesome. The only thing we need to do is like increase the engagement in the first week. And maybe it's true, maybe it's not, but it's not that straightforward. That maybe these users who are really engaged in the first week are types of users who are just because of their more likely they like the product anyways, right? And that's why they're engaged and that's why they bought. Another like example is like we saw in stats that users who skip onboarding, they have a higher, significantly higher sign-up conversions. So we said, okay, we just need to have a big skip button and then, you know, all the conversions will be awesome, or just remove the onboarding. But also, you know, these users who actually skip the onboarding, maybe they already know like what to expect. They don't need onboarding, they will anyway sign up, right? So sometimes it's easy to jump to a conclusion and say, okay, I see this, you know, probably this is because of that, but think about it, whether it's just like correlation and, you know, what comes first. And then, you know, sometimes when you have these assumptions, what's awesome if you can, if you have a supporting architecture and if you have a client or project that can enable you to do so, is to A/B test things. It's basically, you know, you have a new version of your app or a new release on the web, and you made like 50 changes, and you see that, you know, engagement went up or signups went up, and you say, awesome, release. But maybe out of these kind of 50 changes, maybe there were like 5 that actually degraded that same metric, right? And without these, you would have an even higher gain. But you will actually never know because it was all as a bunch of things that you did. So when in doubt, I mean, you have like kind of bigger changes, even if you're pretty sure, and it's so logical that it must be amazing to ship that feature, if possible, A/B test from one side that you can measure. From another side, often you will be surprised how much things that you expect that they will have a great impact actually don't have a great impact. Like, so, you know, in my past we had like features for which we were kind of betting that they would be super awesome. We were investing in them like 3 months of development, and we came to the launch date. We A/B tested them, luckily, and we saw like zero improvement, like zero, no metric was moved, and that was like a shock for us. And so basically, A/B test what enables to test assumptions, also reduce risk. Most of the A/B tests, like you set the initial percentage of users who will see a test treatment, right? So if you set it to 1%, you reduce the risk of introducing something that will damage your metrics. You know, you basically roll it out to 1%, you track metrics. If it's not good, you roll back as nothing has happened, right? Also, you can kind of, in this way, you can fail fast. You can see something is not working. Okay, no harm was made. You don't need to roll a new version of your app that kind of reverts all these changes, right? Also, you can kind of, by having A/B testing, if you A/B test like many small like things, you can have a faster convergence to the best or optimal solution, because you will kind of remove the things that degraded your metrics, and you will actually just roll out the features that had a positive impact. having said all of that, like you need to be aware that, you know, A/B testing has its cost, right? Which is for each A/B combination in your code, you actually need to have both paths and you need to test both paths, right? So it all introduces kind of tech debt complexity and also QA complexity. So imagine if you have like 5 different A/B tests, how many combinations, for example, you would need to test. So, you know, it's advisable to A/B test, but do it with care and don't A/B test every small thing. And also, like, often what happens, A/B test is defined, but actually there's no alignment of what's the success metric or what's the key KPI that you should watch, right? You don't want to have like A/B test and you monitor 20 metrics. You probably want to put like 1 or 2 like metrics and see what was the impact. From my experience, the guidance was that you actually say what metrics you want to move and which are the thresholds after which you either roll out the A/B test like completely to higher percentage of users, or you said that's it. Like, so example, you don't want to say it just needs to be better, right? You probably want to say it needs to, you expect some gain, like, which is, let's say, 1%, right? And if you achieve that threshold, then you kind of say this A/B test was successful, we go forward with that. Another thing, just to be cautious about, especially in products that don't have a lot of users, right, is to gain sufficient amount of data so it's statistically significant. So you don't like see first day, oh, this has improved, woohoo, and then you roll out 100% of users, but actually it was so biased user set that you got false results. Another like topic is what analytics like enable you to identify bottlenecks in your app. You know, where in the whole funnel, you know, from the moment that users see or find out about your product to the actual purchase or renew moment, like where do you see drop-offs? Where do most of the users drop off? So, you know, example, you might have in your sign-up flow, you might have one single screen where you have the biggest drop-off, and then you can see and how you can improve that one screen. Also, what helps is there are some standardized like metrics, like, you know, retention, engagement, sign-up, conversions, which you can also kind of benchmark and see how other products in your segment, what are their kind of values, and you can see whether your product is, you know, behind or is on par with the competition. So we had one product where we figured out we had some retention metric. We didn't know whether it was good or not, right? And then we saw that basically same similar competitor in our basically area had like 2.5 times bigger retention. So that was kind of a big alarm sign for us that, you know, we need to do something about it, that something is wrong with our product. And also you can identify features which are not used at all, and then you can ask yourself whether there is a problem with this probability of this feature, or simply the feature is useless and you can maybe even remove it. Another thing which is, I would say, quite important is kind of user bias. Not all users are the same and they don't behave in the same way. And what maybe some of you notice that you have kind of early and late adopters, so you release a new version of the app, you will see some metrics go up and improve, and then after some time they will kind of drop off and stabilize to the previous state, right? So you have this kind of early adopters population that are more eager to update, that have, you know, there are maybe power users, have better devices, they'll have maybe better performance. And then after late majority and late adopters come, which have maybe lower-end devices, it will come to the same point as your previous version. So this is just a, you know, tip: don't accelerate too early. Just you know, collect enough percentage of users to switch to a newer version before you can kind of conclude how the new version performs. Another thing is regarding comparison between different OSs, devices, regions, platforms. So they're not the same. There was also a reason why some users are on the old OS or some users are on the old device. So if the user has a 5-year-old device, probably that's a user that doesn't care about device, maybe like uses the device pretty rarely. Same thing like about OS version, right? These users are a special type of user. I don't know how to call them, but that's, you know, you need to be just when analyzing and slicing data, it makes sense to slice to kind of isolate these exceptions, right? Because they will skew your data. Also, seasonality. Many products are, I won't say all, but many products from my experience like have seasonal effect. Either it's on a yearly basis, for example, some products have high usage after holiday season and New Year resolution, right? So if they got either the product for as a present, or they made the decision that they will use activity tracker, or that they will learn a language, and then there's a high engagement in January, and then already you see a drop month over month, and then maybe after summer again there's a spike. So sometimes you can get worried, right? You see, oh, what's happening in February? Like, what with my product? But actually, it's just a regular cycle that happens every year, and there's nothing that you can do about it, right? Same thing happens on a weekly basis. Depending on your product, you might have higher or lower usage over the weekend, right? And it also different patterns. Like you might have, let's say, crash rates might differ between the weekend and weekdays, because simply users who use it on weekends are different types of users. You have work versus private users. Also, there are often few spikes in the year, like New Year, for example, Christmas, or like these kind of holidays, where either you might get a huge spike, as we had in Skype. Like Christmas was spike, you cannot even imagine, you know, how big everyone calls everyone on Christmas, right? And it's expected, right? But there are also kind of some weird days that you wouldn't expect that there'll be such a huge spike, like Mother's Day, right? I mean, it's expected, but you wouldn't expect that so many people make calls on that day. But why this is important, because if you ship something the day before that spike day, you might always celebrate, oh my god, what's happening with our engagement, but actually just a coincidence, right? And also, like butterfly effect, sometimes you might change one part, one metric, but it will have a kind of chain reaction and actually have an impact on the completely other metric. I'll show an example later. And so I was talking a lot about analytics and objective data. So something that pretty objective in the sense that the users don't give you their opinion, right? But what, from my experience, is equally important and is another way of analytics is just subjective feedback. Whether it is related to product reviews, social media feedback, you can get information that you cannot get from analytics often, because either you didn't instrument that, or it's hard to actually measure something like that. So we, you know, got like a bunch of really, really useful information from these reviews, which would either help us to improve the product or add additional analytics so we can detect these issues early, right? So, for example, what we've done on a couple of projects is just add send feedback feature in the product. So users can actually let you know what they think about the product. Maybe they have a suggestion for a new feature, maybe they have an issue. And tools like Upboy, for example, enable you to communicate with this user and ask the user like for more information or provide a solution to work around. So it really improves their experience, like if you offer them a workaround, but also gives you feedback to improve your product. And if you can perform user testing, even if it's internally in your company or organize a kind of official user testing, and then you can collect all the assumptions that you want to test with real users in a kind of focus group, which also helps and reduces the cost of kind of rolling it out to a lot of users. One point is like replying to app reviews. Now both Google and Apple enable it for apps, and it's proven to increase the average ratings of the reviews to which you replied. So if they were one star after you reply, either you help or not, basically these users tend to increase their average rating. And just kind of conclusion is like make it a habit. Like analytics, don't look at them like once per year, but try to make it a habit. Some metrics you will track on a daily basis, some on a weekly basis. Try to share insights and communicate in the team about the metrics. So basically that you all remind yourself about what are the pain points in your product, what you wanna improve. Naturally, like after a new release, you wanna put more focus on analytics and check more often. And basically, if you can, just for each new feature, try to make it as a discipline, just to instrument new features, so you know how they're used. And better to be paranoid. If you see some anomaly in analytics, better be paranoid and kind of over careful. Then kind of say, it's probably nothing. And then 2 weeks after, you see that there's something terribly wrong with your product. And few examples. One is from our project, actually I think last year. So we revamped the app, completely redesigned, made a rewrite. All the metrics were awesome, like engagement went up, sign-up conversions went up. Awesome review, awesome feedback from users. Right? But the average app rating dropped like for more than 2.1, and we were like, we weren't sure like what's happening. Actually, all the indicators are positive, but app ratings are awful, right? And what helped us from the analytics is to make the trend, all the app, new app, and see like, okay, we see a drop in app ratings, but we also saw that there was much less ratings in general. So that was kind of a question like, okay, why would behavior of users change, and why would they be less likely to rate? So there was something in the previous set maybe where they had a trigger or something asking users to rate. So actually that was it, right? They had after the user completes the exercise successfully, they would ask for rating, and it's kind of called as a happy trigger. Many products do that, and you probably noticed it. You do some action and then they ask you for feedback. It's not now a kind of common thing to do. And after we implemented, the only thing that we changed between these two versions was actually that, right? And operating went up, and they went to the highest ever rating, right? So if we were just if we weren't monitoring the trend and monitoring the app before and after, and we wouldn't see that there was much smaller amount of ratings, we probably wouldn't. It would probably take us more time to figure out what's actually happening. Another example is where I briefly touched on the A/B testing topic. But here is one positive example. Like we were improving onboarding in our app, and we saw really positive results. We made 5 changes in the UI in that onboarding. But we always wonder now, we didn't do an A/B test, right? And we always wonder whether all these 5 changes had a positive effect if we look at them independently. Maybe one of these 5 changes actually degraded experience, and we actually will never know. We won't do an A/B test again. But this is one example where we're not sure actually which of these 5 changes made the biggest impact. Right? So this is just like encouraging if you can. There are some tools now where you can actually do A/B testing quite lightweight. So it's not that heavy, especially UI changes. So this is one where we're just like wondering. And this is one example where reading app reviews and subjective feedback from users help us to identify an issue which we wouldn't find in analytics, right? So users were struggling with restoring purchase. We didn't have any instrumentation for that to see how many users are actually not managing to restore the purchase. So we were reading the reviews and they were asking like, how do I restore a purchase? I purchased the old app, now it doesn't work. So basically, we had this feedback from Envoy and app reviews, and basically we addressed that issue. And the conclusion is basically analytics don't reveal everything, right? You still need to read subjective feedback, do user testing, and read the product reviews. And another one example is regarding the butterfly effect. So some of you might be familiar with iOS 10.3 feature where they introduced the ability that you actually rate the app from the app. And we were really unsure like what would be the impact of that change. We had a couple of theories, like, you know, users won't see your average review, maybe they won't be biased by that, they will give you a lower rating. So we were kind of really afraid of what will impact it. So in the end, it was really positive impact, and I would strongly suggest anyone to do the same. We got more ratings and higher average up rating. So we came to the highest ever average up rating, but that wasn't the only thing that we improved. And there was a really chain reaction and the, like a butterfly effect, where the higher ratings led to higher rankings, to kind of higher positive initial impact that increased our sign-up conversion, although we didn't change anything in the sign-up process. It just like sign-up conversion increased after that. And that led to kind of higher engagement and in the end to higher revenue, which we didn't, when we were making this change in the app, we didn't think that, that actually it will increase our revenue. Like we were just hoping to kind of maybe increase the rating, but overall effect because of all this was more than we were hoping for. And kind of recap is, you know, use the analytics from day one, like when you start a project, just make sure that you track the key events and key screens. Define your top KPIs, you know, like think about like what's your actually goal of the app. Like, you might be in a phase where you just want to have more users, or you might be in a phase where you actually want to earn money from the day one. Focus on the end result, not the feature set. Think about biases and seasonalities. Don't jump to conclusions if you see some, you know, correlation. Don't think that you know, users are doing that because of that. A/B test when possible, and you know, use subjective feedback as much as you can, and you know, to, gather this info, and you know, use analytics regularly. So yeah, this is the last slide. I'm not sure how much the time was. I probably. Questions? Just easy questions.
Which tools do you usually use for collecting data?
So Google, unfortunately many tools, but
Fabric.
Yeah, I would say Fabrics and like Fabric and Crashlytics for Crash. Google Analytics for kind of user behavior, flow, screens, and all this stuff. Appboy for kind of subjective feedback and for example, seeing like success metrics of marketing campaigns. So these three things.
Other questions? Okay, we're going to have a panel now, so I hope there's more questions. I have some. So I'm going to be on the panel along with Rachel, Karshmir, I don't know if you prefer, and Felix from Infinim. Also, and we're going to have a fourth seat in case anyone wants to join us. I was so worried.
That's the secret, right?
That's good. I like it. It's like a daily. Okay, so are you product or project manager?
Project manager.
Of products, though, right? Because you're you do
I guess both. I guess yeah. Both. Mostly projects.
Okay. And you're a product manager, right?
On paper, I'm project manager. But since client often doesn't do all the product management responsibilities, so I like do a lot of these product.
That's
management.
Not okay. You gotta push that stuff back.
I know.
One.
Yeah, I'm a project manager, but I have some smaller products also. So.
Okay. And I do both.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do both also. Mainly, I'm a project manager. So I guess my first kind of question or comment is, if we're project managers, how do we use metrics? So if I'm building software for somewhere else, what can I do? a tough question right off.
So I can say from my experience, like, I on paper, as I said, like project manager, but since, you know, I started doing it because we had access to analytics, I started sharing these insights with the client. And basically, there was really positive feedback from each client that we've done. So I would kind of strongly suggest that as kind of added value, but it also helps you as a project manager to identify like measure problems in your project.
And you guys charge for that added value, right?
No.
How much time do you spend doing that compared to for a project manager?
I would say that maybe 10% or something like that.
10%.
If you have, let's say you have a sprint, like a 2-week long sprint, and you have some A/B testing, are your developers involved in analyzing this, or is it just the product managers? And how do you come to decisions about what to do next? Sure. I mean, anyone can answer. You guys can answer too.
Yeah. So usually it's a data analyst or product manager, but it's usually like data analyst responsible.
Yeah, so that was also my question. Do you have the actual analytics people, some data analysts, or the people whose actual responsibility is to think about analytics, think about what to measure, why measuring, and then later drawing some conclusions? Because do you have those in your company? Like somebody who is a person, yeah, a dedicated person for analytics things, you know, whatever.
Yeah, we don't.
No. So that's basically something what's expected from project managers.
No, but you don't see that way. So in 5, our UX designers as well are supposed to refocus on the metrics while they are designing the UX flows, as well as the project managers. So basically, our philosophy from the past few years is that everybody in the team should be familiar with the metrics and the data that is important for that product. So the project manager in the project is basically the person who is leading that whole agenda about the metrics. But the UX designer, UI designer, they all have to be focused on the KPIs that the client has defined or we help him. So basically, you know, it's not one person. We don't have the BI or data analyst person sitting there and doing all the reports for all the products. I don't think that's happening in any agency.
Yeah, so I guess there's also, everybody has their own tool or their own, so let's say you also ask the developers participate. So I'm guessing if it's something to measure through Crashlytics, that's obviously going to be something that developers are going to react to, right? Because it's measuring crashes and some things like that. But you can also measure some other things through analytics and some other tools. So I'm guessing that everybody has their own field,
their own path into the
right
data.
Yeah, but you can share the experience from your project, like you're sharing the data on a weekly basis with the whole team, even the developers. Like they do track crash analytics as focused for them because they have to sort out the crashes, but basically, Crash is actually sharing the metric about the project to the developers. Like,
this is the status. This is what we.
Yeah. Like,
yeah. Especially when we want to move some metric and we released a new version, and then we're tracking like how it maps. I think, you know, after initial releases on the project, basically it's not even weekly. It's like every couple of days when we see some movement. To do kind of the same thing. But you know what we are trying to make the change as well, that you know everyone in the company is aware of why we are actually doing it. Like,
do you have any problems if you have a client who's not on board to do the analytics part, and how do you convince them to do it?
This is the same. It's the same way you do how you sell unit testing. It's not optional. This is part of what you're buying from us. You're buying a good product, so you get analytics, unit testing, or whatever, integration testing, or whatever you want to do. And this is part of the package. This is part of the deliverable. That doesn't work, but
didn't have any problems with clients who would actually want to implement events. But actually, there was from their end, they didn't analyze that the data. That was just there, available, but no one was taking care of it, right? And there, therefore, kind of, I was maybe doing the wrong thing, but I stepped out and kind of started sharing to them.
Yeah, I think it's one thing to define some events that are tracking coherent, because that's what you think that they need, but actually, the insight they need is only known by them. So only the client knows what's the actual KPI they need. And
yeah.
You're here to help them define it, right?
So do you guys write user stories for your clients, or do you have like a product owner that writes user stories? Because in my experience, I found if they're writing user stories, or I'm trying to get them to write rough user stories, not, of course, very good, but they give me the whole story then. They understand the because, blah, 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 and why it's important. And then from there, I can figure out, oh, you want to change this because you're not seeing as many signups. And then I can ask them that directly. So is that something that you guys do, or?
On our projects, we mostly do user stories on our end.
Yeah.
And we just get a glimpse of what the client really wants through the email or to call. On some projects, we do have the client is writing the actual user story, but that's rarely.
Very rare, right?
Yeah.
And
it's quite hard to explain sometimes what you actually expect, what do they need to write, what to focus on. So you just try and motivate them to just write about it, think about it in a way, and then in the end, you have to adapt it on your own, and you have to draw some conclusions from that. So I think it really varies from client to client, and also from product to product. I mean, in our company, we do a lot of websites, which are not so firmly defined as a product sometimes, because oftenly it just exists as a project for a couple of months until it's done. And then what's the saddest thing, usually the client doesn't care what happens afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't even communicate or convince them, we need to analyze, we need to track, we need to draw conclusions, we need to upgrade, because they don't look at it that way. It's just like they ordered something else to be delivered, and once it's delivered, that's pretty much it. And that's also a bit different because websites are often just a marketing channel that doesn't drive direct revenue, like maybe some apps which are actually bought through stores. And it often happens on our side that clients just don't look at it that way. And it's even sad that it happens if you think about analytics, we implement. But later on, nobody analyzes it. And you cannot analyze it because you're really not getting paid for it. And it's just up to anybody who will come maybe later to try and see that data and do something about it. So I don't know if that happens with your projects or with your...
I would argue that I would...
So when you say it cannot be discussed, yeah, well, you just don't discuss it. It's like that. And that's it.
I think that this involves like not necessarily the sales team, but the business has to put forward and say, look, we're building this structure for you so that you can keep learning and keep getting better, and we want to help you. That's a long-term relationship, rather than building a website for 3 months and sending it off to its death. You know, it's something that we're going to build together for a long time.
All of the overall the project.
Yeah. But you have to sell that.
So there's some kind of a philosophy or some kind of rhetorics or something. Again, it depends.
But that's not on you, I don't think. I mean, maybe you can talk clients into doing this or getting add-ons and upgrading, upselling them.
You mean if it's up to a project manager or
yeah.
up to somebody who actually sells
the key account manager?
The key account, yeah.
It depends on who the client trusts the most.
Absolutely.
So if you're the one who's doing most of the communication with the client, then it's you.
It probably is, yeah.
I have an additional question. So in case you're building a new version of the app, are you defining analytics and data capture plan upfront, or that's something that you figure out, oh, we need to do it in the last week or month.
Yeah, so when you talk about the KPIs, when you talk about which analytics are important.
Because I had a situation when we did develop a product and it was mostly done, and then we said, okay, we need to add analytics, and developers were like, okay, but why we didn't know that from the start, it would be easier. So I just want to see your...
Yeah, for us, it's kind of in the project template, whenever we even start like estimating the project, like analytics are always like a default thing. It's like Steve said, it's non-negotiable. We need to have analytics, we need to have integration at least with some of these analytics tools. So the high level, top level kind of KPIs will definitely be tracked, but it all then depends about custom events. And that's where we can kind of ask the client, you know, which custom events we want to track. But you know, screen flow and you know, retention engagement, this thing is like default. I think that should never be optional.